When will SpaceX's Starship serial number 10 launch? What does it do differently, and how high are its chances of a successful landing? How will Rocket Lab send humans to space with their new Neutron rocket? Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Looks like it's handled.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. All systems go for launch. SpaceX seems to be ready for launch on Starship serial number 10. Elon Musk's latest prototype is sitting in Boca Chica, Texas, ready to give it another go. Make sure to watch today's episode until the end, as there is an important announcement for the Y family you can participate in. And Mauricio from RGV Aerial Photography, as always, did one of his flybys. As one of his patrons, you can get early access to all of these pictures. Help him if you can and give him some money for the next flight. And here's one of the best looking changes SpaceX has made to the launch site in a long time. They finally added their typical paint job to the landing pad. In Mary's footage, you can also see that the inner ring now has that typical yellow color. These markings have a tradition at SpaceX. Here, for example, you can see some footage of one of two SpaceX's autonomous drone ships. This one, for example, is called Of Course I Still Love You, and it's even written on the deck next to the markings. The second one is called Just Read the Instructions, and soon they will even be joined by a third one. A Shortfall of Gravitas. All three names are nods to the famous author Ian Banks' sci-fi novel series Culture, published from 1987 to 2012. They are names of spaceships. Now, SpaceX has never named land-based landing pads. The two in Florida are just called LZ1 and 2. But wouldn't it be cool if SpaceX named this pad? There are a few fitting spaceship names left in the Culture series. How about So Much for Subtlety or Funny It Worked Last Time? Just a little suggestion here for SpaceX. But SpaceX is good at picking up jokes anyway. Do you remember the term when hop, which originated from La Padre's Nerdle community? Let me introduce you to Raptor Engine 47 or Thunder Chicken. When hop, much wow. I just love the way SpaceX picks up terms from the community. They are watching us as much as we are watching them, and this creates a very special and incredibly unique bond. Have you ever seen a Delta IV Heavy with Tory Bruno's teeth on it chomping SpaceX to bits? SpaceX is different in many ways, and that's what makes them so lovable. Here's another good one. This is one of the recent engine deliveries photographed by Jack Beyer from NASA Spaceflight. On a more serious note, SpaceX doesn't just joke around. They also deliver. Here you can see Starship serial number 10 on the test stand as seen on NASA Spaceflight. They do an absolutely awesome job of delivering broadcasts from down there, and this is the second static fire for Starship serial number 10. Everything looks perfect, and this sets the stage for yet another Starship test flight. Maybe even as soon as tomorrow. Late on Sunday evening, Mary, aka Boca Chica Girl, already received an evacuation notice for Monday, which was revoked again only a few hours later. But this tells us that SpaceX is very close to another launch now. My livestream is already set up in cooperation with La Padre, and we're getting ready for another hype train or two. Set a reminder and don't forget to get your favorite food ready. These streams tend to be a bit longer sometimes, but every second is gold watching it all unfold live with the Y family. Looking at another picture from Mauricio, we can get a clear view at the new fuel farm taking shape at the SpaceX Starship launch site. Three tank foundations can be spotted on the already finished part of the foundation, and two more are starting to take shape on the more unfinished part. Since the lower part of the foundation facing the water has exactly the same shape as the top one, we might see another two tank foundations here soon. That would make it a total of 8 possible tanks to be erected here. Very large ones, too. The second very interesting spot next to it is taking shape more and more as well. These pipes sticking out of the ground are all connected. In this picture from RGV from January 1st, you can see it a bit better. These are actually long U-shaped pipes. On one end connected via the main pipe channel coming from the old tank farm, and on the other end leading towards the orbital launch mount. SpaceX will want liquid oxygen, liquid methane, and liquid nitrogen here at best, and water for a deluge and fire extinguisher system. What's your guess? Where will the different commodities go? Tell me in the comments. SpaceX has also been working on these large domes for a while now. They are being constructed at the Well site, where SpaceX is also right now building a fuel production refinery for methane and liquid oxygen. Here's another view from NASA spaceflight. They are huge in diameter and they are kind of crudely made. Does this look like something that's supposed to hold a high pressure? In one of RGV's panoramic shots from last Saturday, we can get an idea of how wide they are. Compared to the hull segments at the construction site, they are at least a third wider, almost double in fact. Early on, there was a rumor that these could be a prototype dome construction for Starships. That can now definitely be ruled out. Another theory now is that these domes might be for the orbital launch site. If we compare the round foundations at the orbital launch site with the diameter of serial number 7.2, though, we can see that it's about the same size. If we now try to fit one of those domes from the Well site on top of these foundations at the launch site, that doesn't really fit. Maybe a big tank and a small one next to each other, but that sounds strange. Are those domes for something different than the launch site? They would, after all, fit in the spot where they are made right now. Why would SpaceX make separate foundations at the Well site just to craft domes? Couldn't they just do that in the construction tents? And there's another clue as to what sort of tanks will be used at the construction site. What you're looking at here is the preparation for the sleeving of a rather strange dome. With the shape of a forward Starship dome, it does have some sort of pipe sticking out on top, which you normally can't find on a Starship dome. It's labeled as GSE dome, which normally stands for ground support equipment in rocket talk. Ground support equipment would be a fuel or water tank, for example, so there's a high chance that this tank will be installed on the foundations that can be seen at the new fuel farm at the orbital launch site. In return, if SpaceX uses Starship segments for tank construction at the new fuel farm, the larger domes from the Well site wouldn't make much sense. And the refinery complex is steadily growing, and SpaceX might need storage tanks here too. In fact, the construction effort SpaceX is putting into this part of the infrastructure by now rivals the launch site. The Boca Chica methane and oxygen production plant is going to be yet another significant investment for SpaceX. Looking at an object at the small bay, we have yet another very interesting development to discuss. This is titled the serial number 15 nose cone in the community, and there's something strange going on here. Look at the very tip of the nose. Do you see it? Here's another view from the ground and through Mary's lens. It's flat, cut off by SpaceX workers and being used for unknown purpose. Back in November of last year, Musk stated on Twitter that Starship serial number 15 would have major upgrades. But is this really it, or are we looking at a Pathfinder? Maybe a lunar Starship mockup that will receive an airlock in the nose tip where we'd normally find one of the header tanks? Lunar Starships might not need any header tanks, as they are not supposed to land back on Earth and will utilize special descent engines located on the side of the hull. But that can't be found on this nose cone yet. It is missing flaps but has hinges for them, and it had the nose tip removed after originally being built with one. It will be very interesting to see if this really is for Starship serial number 15 or if it is for something completely different. Recently, this picture was tweeted by Stephen Clark. It shows mock-up builds of Dynetics, Blue Origin, and SpaceX for the Artemis Lunar Lander program. The picture in the middle shows a supposed lunar Starship crane mock-up quickly built by SpaceX to demonstrate the concept to NASA. Now, I couldn't confirm if those pictures were released by NASA or how Mr. Clark got his hands on them, but he's a journalist for spaceflightnow.com, so I'll trust the source for now. Looking at an official concept shot, the crane system is visible on the side of the hull coming down from a single hatch opening. The hatch, of course, is located above the tank section. Looking at the nose cone with the cut-off nose again does not reveal a hatch of any sort, so the purpose for now stays unknown. All eyes are on Starship serial number 10 at the moment, which will try to improve on the landing by relighting all three Raptor engines. Contrary to Starship serial number 9, which only relit the needed two engines for the landing burn and failed because one engine did not ignite properly, this should in theory give SpaceX the needed redundancy to finally perform a good landing. Again though, this is prototyping. Elon Musk predicted that the chance is 60% for Starship serial number 10 to actually make it, and that is a good indicator for how likely another failure is, according to the lead engineer himself. Just a bit less likely than a success. Do not miss the live stream and let's find out together. Now, let's have a look at Rocket Lab entering the medium lift rocket business. The Y family needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe, and share it with your friends on Twitter or Facebook to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Gain access to our Discord server, where you can meet me and the rest of the team or get a completely ad-free release of each and every episode, provided just for members. Or do you know about the Y warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt and look as awesome as you feel. Links can be found in the description. You rock. Rocket Lab's Neutron Rocket. This one comes with a bang. Rocket Lab, known for its carbon fiber small lift launch vehicle Electron, is introducing a new rocket. A reusable one. A big one. One that's capable of human spaceflight. Introducing their first rocket to the public in 2014, Rocket Lab has since broken many records. The world's first carbon fiber composite rocket to reach space, the first 3D printed rocket engine to reach space, and the first electric pump cycle engine ever produced. Every 24 hours, one engine can be printed. The world's first private orbital launch site. Launching Electron rockets since May 2017, they've delivered 97 satellites to orbit so far and managed to do one of the most difficult things you can do in the rocket industry: to be successful as a private competitor. Now Rocket Lab wants to go on. They want to continue the success story, and for that they need something bigger. Introducing Neutron to the rocket industry is the logical step to take. A bigger rocket for bigger tasks ahead. There's not much known about it yet. 8 tons to Leo and 1.5 tons to Mars or Venus. Reusable first stage, and on top of all that, it's supposed to be human spaceflight capable. Casper Stanley has made a first animation for us, and Rocket Lab has released a detailed render, and both together show Rocket Lab's new workhorse in detail. Rocket Lab has not settled on the hull material yet, but it won't be carbon composite like on the Electron rocket, as re-entry heat makes a tougher material necessary. Currently, Rocket Lab utilizes the 3D printed Rutherford engine for their Electron rocket, but it won't even be nearly as strong enough for that task. A new engine has to be developed. Good news for the US East Coast. The rocket and the engines will be built and launched near Rocket Lab's new launch complex at Wallops. A new facility will be built, and they are currently holding a competition as to where exactly that will be. Hundreds of new jobs will be created in the process, and it will be close to Wallops for efficiency reasons. First stages are supposed to land on ocean platforms. Very similar to SpaceX's solution and the way to go right now. And how does Rocket Lab finance this endeavor? Rocket Lab is partnering with Vector, a private investment firm focused on the technology sector, and will go public later this year on the stock market. They will be listed as RKLB on the NASDAQ, which should be sufficient to fund such a large project. Rocket Lab continues to impress, and there aren't many companies out there to stand by their word as much as Peter Beck does. Good luck, Rocket Lab, you Rocket Lab. Here's an announcement for those watching the entire episode. We are working on a new website for the space community and have big plans. We just want to make sure that those plans are on the right track. If you want to help, fill out the form and give us some ideas. A link can be found in the description. Thank you. Ever wondered what you need to know to do what I do for a living? Check out today's sponsor. This is Sorelle Amore, almost 1 million subscribers, and as most YouTubers, she's loving her job. But the best thing is, she teaches about it on Skillshare. Whether you've always dreamed of becoming a YouTube star and didn't know where to start, or you've had an active YouTube channel for years and it didn't kick off, Sorelle's authentic, focused approach will help you unlock a whole new way of making it work. Figure out what to bring to the table online. Find your topic niche and evolve it over time. Prioritize authenticity over looks. The first 1,000 people to click the link in my description will get a free trial of Skillshare's premium membership. And after that, it's only $10 a month. Click link, get free learning from the best, and support What About It at the same time? Easy, right? Links in the description. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Ron C, Greg, Christopher Harvard, Nicholas Morales, Ramon Meister, Greg Underwood, and many others. You rock. Without you and all the other supporters, What About It would not be possible. Thank you for your support, enjoy today's ad-free release, and don't forget to join us on our Y Discord server. I am looking forward to thanking you in person. Today's team shoutout goes to Brian. You might not have heard of him yet, but trust me, you will. He's our new editorial genius, and he's getting to know our workflow and the team right now. The whole team is happy to have you on board, Brian, and we're looking forward to turning our vision into reality with your help. Thank you, Brian. You rock. There's a rendering on Rocket Lab's homepage which reveals a few more details, though. Give me a second. The door just magically opened. Casper Stanley has made a first...
Has made a...
Rocket Lab has not settled on the hull material yet, but it... Composite.
Yeah, it's composite.